walk the narrow way for the comforter of my way. With me everywhere, and he knows my every care. I'm as happy as a bird and just as free. For the Spirit has control, Jesus satisfies my soul, since the Comforter abides with me. He abides, he abides, hallelujah, he abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way. The Comforter abides with me. There's no thirsting for the things of the world. They've taken wings. Long ago I gave them up and instantly all my nights turned to day, all my burdens rolled away. Now the Comforter abides with me. He abides. As I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me.
I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward this time to receive this evening's offering. Brother David Mullins, will you come ask a blessing over the offering?
Let us pray.
Dear Lord, once again, we'd like to thank you for a wonderful day, for a wonderful service that we had this morning. And dear Lord, we thank you for each and every one that come out tonight to hear the preacher tonight. Dear Lord, may you give him a good message on his heart and give him the Spirit of the Lord to deliver that message. And dear Lord, we pray that you'd bless our hearts and our minds and bless this money that we're about to receive to where we can further your kingdom. And all these things we do ask in your Son's holy name. Amen.
There's a happy land of promise over in the great beyond, where the saint of earth shall sing the glory share, where the souls of men shall enter and live on forevermore. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be happy over there. We will shout and sing his praise. Everybody will be over there. Mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers will be singing round the throne in that land where no one ever knows a care. And the Christians of all ages will join in the triumph song. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be happy, will be happy. We'll be happy over there. We will hear nobody praying and no mourning in that land, for no burdens there will be for us to bear. All the people will be singing glory, glory to the Lamb. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be happy, will be happy over there. We will shout and sing his praise. Everybody will be happy over there.
Hurry up, shake hands with your neighbor tonight. There we'll meet the one who saved us and who kept us by his grace and who brought us to that land so bright and fair. We will praise his name forever as we look upon his face. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be happy, will be happy over there. We will shout and sing his praise. Everybody will be happy over there.
Amen. You can be seated. Give Matthew a hand as he comes and sings for us tonight.
A couple weeks ago, I received the news that one of my favorite aunts had went home to be with the Lord, and I had just heard this song right before, and I know now why I had heard it right then, because it just, knowing that she served a risen Savior and that she's in heaven, what blessed assurance that gives me.
Leaving behind all my sorrows.
seems to me. Kid G.
It's a country where no twilight shadows deepen. An ending day where night shall never be. A city where no storm clouds ever gather. Now this is just what heaven means to me. Oh, what will it be when we get over yonder and we join that throne around the crystal sea? It's a place where there is no misunderstanding. From all enmity and all strife, we're free. No unkind words to earn the at last we see the face of Jesus, and before his image other loves all flee. And when they crown him, what will it be?
Come on, preacher.
Man, good to be back tonight. Amen. I'm glad we've got a God that's bigger than a Super Bowl. Amen.
Amen.
I don't care nothing about that. I was in the prayer room with these fellas praying, and man, my prayer tonight is that God just show up in this place,
amen,
manifest himself in here, and I promise you, you won't care a thing about the Super Bowl,
amen, right,
if God shows up, amen. Again, thank you for having me this weekend. Thank you for your hospitality. Everything, man. I ate so much at lunch today. That salad, boy. I love salad. Amen. My son's just like that. But thank you so much for everything. It's just a joy to be here, to be in this pulpit. I don't take it lightly. I talked to your preacher just a little bit ago on text, and I told him I don't take it lightly to stand in this place and stand behind this desk. And so thank you so much for having me. You pray for us over the next few months. We're going to be busy traveling. If you didn't stop by our table, you stop by those CDs are free on that table. I figure if you want to listen to them, bless God, I ain't going to charge you for them, okay? But those CDs are free, so if you want some of those, go and take those. The only thing we sell on our table is our towels. I was telling Brother Lucas today, I carry this towel everywhere I go. You never see me preach without this towel. And the bad thing is, and I'm going to fill you in on a secret, I don't tell everybody, but I ain't washed this towel since I was in high school. And I ain't playing with you. So you'll see some people shy away from it. My wife won't even touch it. But I told her, that's got the anointing on it. I carry this towel everywhere I go, and some people ask me, they say, why do you carry that towel? Why is it so important to you? It's not just for sweat or nothing like that, although it does come in handy. But I carry this towel because when I was going through a bad time in my life, and God was dealing with my heart, and we had just lost our first child, and man, I had got to the place where I wanted to quit, and I really walked into church one day figuring I was done. Walked in with my mind made up I was going to throw in my towel. And a group out of Gaffney, South Carolina, y'all would love them. They're rednecks, amen. They come in and they sang a song called I'm Going to Pick Up My Towel. And from that day on, I decided that I wasn't going to let the devil rob me of my joy. And I wasn't going to let the devil tell me to throw in my towel. So every time the devil gets on my nerves, I just wave it at him and let him know,
amen,
that I still got it. But we made up some towels. We got those on our table. And those go, that's just gas money. Amen. And Jeremy will be running the table afterwards. So if you want to go by there and see him, go by there and see him. Amen. But again, thank you so much for having us. If you have your Bibles tonight, turn to the book of Mark, chapter number 8. Mark chapter number 8 tonight. Familiar text in the Word of God, and I'll be honest, I'm probably not going to tell you anything tonight that you don't know already. But Mark chapter number 8, we're going to start reading in verse number 22. So if you would, please stand when you find your place. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
If you're still looking, say amen.
Amen.
We'll wait on you, bless God. Thank God for screens, amen. If you don't know where you're going, just look up at the screen. I tell you another funny story when you turn in. It happened to me here. I wasn't paying attention during the youth revival. I was sitting over there, and something had happened, and I was talking to somebody, and Israel was right beside me. And the preacher was preaching, it was Preacher Jacob that night. I was talking to somebody, and he said, turn the Song of Solomon. Well, I'm flipping through my Bible, and it looked like I didn't know where I was going. Israel said, brother, you need me to help you find that? And I said, man, I ain't never going to talk again in church because I look like a fool right then. But Mark chapter number 8, verse number 22, the Bible says, and he cometh to Bethsaida, and they bring a blind man unto him and besought him to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of town. And when he had spit on his eyes, he put his hands upon him and asked him if he saw aught. And he looked up and said, I see men as trees walking. After that, he put his hands again upon his eyes and made him look up. And he was restored and saw every man clearly. And he sent him away to his house, saying, neither go into the town nor tell it to any in the town. Let's pray. Father, we love you today. God, we thank you for the spirit that we felt here this week, this day. God, we thank you for what you've done. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for who you are. And God, we ask you right now to come into this place. God, fill us tonight. God, I pray, Lord, you begin moving in this place right now, God, that we'd feel your very presence. Lord, we understand that there is no ball game or anything bigger than you. And Father, we've come tonight to meet with you. And Lord, we pray, God, that you would just move in this place and speak to hearts. Lord, we pray, Father, tonight that you'd anoint me, God. Lord, use me one more time, God, this side of heaven. Lord, I pray you'd anoint me. Lord, I pray, God, that you'd cleanse me of sin, empty me of self, fill me with the Holy Ghost of God. Lord, I pray that if there's anybody in here tonight struggling, downhearted, discouraged, Lord, that they would leave here different than what they came. Lord, understanding, God, that we have power through the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we love you. God, we thank and praise you. God, give us traveling grace tonight. Lord, I pray, God, you'll be with my wife and my babies while I'm gone. Lord, I love you. God, I thank and praise you in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. You can be seated tonight. Here in Mark chapter number 8, we find a story of a blind man. It's not that uncommon throughout the Word of God to find a story of a blind man in the Word. I began to ask myself the question, wonder why it's so important for God to keep putting in the Word about him healing the blind. Now, we find him healing the lame, and we find him making the dead to rise and all these other things, but we find oftentimes him speaking of the blind, of him healing the blind. We've got blind Bartimaeus over in a few more chapters. We've got a blind man in John. We've got other blind that Jesus has healed. Why is it so important that he continues to write about the blind? Well, I believe it is because of what Proverbs says. Proverbs says, where there is no vision, the people will perish. See, God is concerned with the way that we see things. He's concerned with the vision of his people. We've got it all mixed up nowadays because what used to be sin, we don't see as sin anymore. Can I get an amen there? We used to look at things as wrong, and we used to say we would never do those things in the church house. But in 2015, we have found that a lot of things have changed. The vision of God, God's people have changed. What used to be wrong is not wrong, but God is still concerned with the way that we view sin. He's still concerned with the way that we see him, with the way that we see this world. It is important tonight that the Christian's vision is 2020 on him, that we're looking unto Jesus. The Bible says in Hebrews, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Our eyes are to be set upon him. But so many times, like Peter, when he was walking on the water in the storm, the Bible said that the wind became boisterous, and he took his eyes off of Jesus, and he began to sink. Hey, I will tell you tonight, there are families sinking. There are people sinking and falling by the wayside because we've taken our eyes off the Lord. But he's concerned tonight with the way that we're seeing things, and we need to make sure before we leave this place that I see him clearly. If you want a title for tonight, this is it. Can you see me now? I began to think about that title. Can you see me now? Here comes Jesus into town. Here comes Jesus on his way. And the Bible, I love the Word of God because I love the little things you catch. It said, and they bring a blind man unto him. Who is they? Who is they here? See, you got to understand that blind men in these times, blind men were considered to be less than men. They were not considered to be a full man because they could not provide. They could not work and make money. They couldn't do the things that other men do. But all day, every day, they would sit by the highway side begging. You would find that about blind Bartimaeus. He was found by the highway side begging. They would beg for money, and people would come by and they would spit on these men. They would kick them. They would mock them. They would hit them and treat them that they were nothing. And so I started to say, who is they? If everybody didn't like this man, if they treated him like an outcast, who is they? Somewhere, somebody cared about this man. Somewhere, somebody, a group of people loved this man enough to say, hey, Jesus is on his way through town. Maybe, just maybe, if we get him to Jesus, he'll change his life. If we go get him to Jesus, Jesus will change everything. You say, what's that got to do with me? Do you know anybody in your family, friend, that's lost and on their way to hell? If we just get them to Jesus, maybe he'll change their life. Hey, Dr. Phil ain't gonna do it. There ain't no preacher gonna do it. But if we get them to Jesus, he'll change them. He'll touch them. We've got to love this world enough to get out in the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in. Do you love the world enough to go tell them about a man named Jesus? It does not matter the color of your skin, black, white, green, or yellow. I should love you enough to let you know that there's a God that loves you. There's a God that'll forgive you. And if I can just get you to Jesus, he'll change your life. I believe the problem with the church today is we have lost the vision to see folks saved. We've made it about money. We've made it about popularity and fame and notoriety. But friend, let me tell you about something. It's still about Jesus. It's still about letting a lost and a dying world know that there's a Savior that'll wash their sins away. That there's a Savior that'll forgive them. There's a Savior that'll change them. Somewhere somebody cared about the blind man. Can't you see him when they got to him? Hey, blind man, we heard Jesus was coming to town. I can hear that blind man say, what's that got to do with me? Well, let me tell you about this man, Jesus. We've heard he's calmed troubled waters. He's walked on the water. He's made the dead to rise. He's made the dumb to talk. He's done all of this. If he can do all of that, he can give you your sight. I wish to God tonight that the church would get on fire about telling the world what Jesus done for you. What he brought you from. Hey, where did he say you from? Some of you got it. Hey, he got some of you off a bar stool. Thank God that he found me where I was and saved me. It's up to us to let this world know that Jesus saves. Amen. Jesus saves. I began to think about the life of this blind man. And we know the story, okay? But now Jesus comes to him. Jesus is in the town. Jesus comes through the town, and they began to bring him to where Jesus is. Now notice the text. We're going to study just a few things, and then we're gone, okay? Notice what he says. And they bring a blind man and besought him. They begged him. They begged him. Do you get that? And they begged him. They begged him. They went to him. Oh, they went to Jesus on this man's behalf. They got down and begged him, said, Lord, would you touch the blind man? Oh, Lord, would you touch him? When's the last time you got on your face and said, oh God, Lord, would you touch the lost? Oh God, would you open their eyes? Lord, would you touch this community? God, would you touch my family? When's the last time you begged and you pleaded with God to save that lost loved one? They begged him. And the Bible said, now watch. And he took the blind man by the hand, and he led him out of town. Now, I got stuck. All right. Now, I want to go ahead and tell you, verses 22 through 26 messed me up. There's some stuff that went on in verses 22 through 26 that messed me up for months. I did not understand why God did what he did in verses 22 through 26, but I'm just going to show you tonight what he showed me. Number one, you see that he removed this man to get the healing that he needed. He removed him from where he was. Now, notice the Bible said that he is in Bethsaida. He's in a place of Bethsaida. Understand, that Jesus had already cursed the ground of Bethsaida back in Matthew. You say, why did he remove him? Because Jesus had already cursed that place. He had cursed it because they had rejected the man. They had rejected his message and they had rejected his miracles. And Jesus cursed the ground of Bethsaida. And he said, I've got to remove him from the crowd. I've got to get him away from the crowd. Do you understand today that our young people are getting sucked in by the crowd? They're going to these new churches nowadays popping up all over the United States where they're told they can live like hell and still go to heaven. They're preached the watered-down version and everything's supposed to be fine. They're drawn in by the crowd. But friend, let me tell you something. He ain't always in the crowd. The Bible says where two or three are gathered in his name, there he will be in the midst. It ain't always in the crowd where the Spirit of God is, but sometimes I'll find him by myself. Sometimes when I break away from everybody else, I'll feel him. I'll touch him. Bless God. Sometimes it's in the private times that I feel him. And now this man has been taken by the hand and led out of town. Jesus got him away from the cursed ground. He got him away from the cursed place. Let me just chase this rabbit for a second. You know what else helped me right there? Jesus already cursed the ground, but yet the Bible said he passed through Bethsaida. He had already cursed it. Why did he go back? They ain't no different than what happened with us. In Genesis, he cursed it. He cursed this place. Hey, glory to God. But one day in Matthew, there was a baby born that he came back to offer help for you and I. Good God, I wish somebody helped me tonight. I'm glad that he's still passing through, that he still comes by for you and I, that he's still looking for the lost. I'm glad the Bible said he came to seek and to save that which was lost. I was lost, but thanks be to God, now I've been found. He came and he got him. And he began to lead him out of town. He removed him from the crowd, from the people. He had to remove him from the place. He had to remove him from all the stuff. Sometimes you've got to get out of the crowd you're running with. If you want to get a touch of Jesus, if you want to get the blessings of God, you've got to break away from those people that you're running with. Sometimes it means walking away from friends. Oh, yes, walking away from them friends that's bringing you down. You can't live like hell and expect heaven to be a blessing. You've got to walk away from it. Hey, if Ruth... Hey, glory. If Ruth would have stayed in Moab, she would have never met Boaz. But because one day she looked at Naomi and said, honey, your God will be my God. I'm going with you. She left everything she knew and she found Boaz. Hey, you've got to get up from where you're living. You can't still live in sin. You can't live out there in the world. You've got to be separate. You've got to get up and follow him. Some of us want the blessing of God, but we want to live like hell. People wonder why I go out clubbing on Saturdays and all this stuff and can't get the help of God on Sunday. You can't straddle the fence, friend. The Bible says if you're neither hot nor cold, if you're lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. That word spew, it's an angry spit. Because you're not living over here nor over there. You've got to make a choice tonight. Either you're for him or you're against him. He said, if you want the help, let's go. And he led him out of town. He removed him from the crowd. But watch this now. He removed him from the constraints. Now think about this. The Bible says that tells us about these blind men and even blind Bartimaeus sitting by the wayside begging. And if you study out, I told you, you'd find that these men were hit and spit and mocked and persecuted for who they were. So every day of his life, he sat by the wayside and people would come by and say, you're never going to be nothing but just an old blind man. You ain't never going to be nothing but just what you are right there. Anybody ever told you that? You ain't never going to be nothing but what what you are. Hey, I had a man tell me one day, he said, my whole life, all I've heard is you ain't gonna be nothing but a drunk like your daddy. He said, that's all I've heard my whole life. This man had been told that he could not. He had been told no constantly over in his life. And that begins to play on your mind, does it not? The words of people begin to play on your mind. And you think just because they said that I can't, then I can't. And you say, how do you know about it? When I stepped into evangelism and I had pastored for about 5 years and God was blessing our church and we had built a new building and people were being saved and baptized into the family of God. And man, God was just blessing. And no problem, no issue, but God said, son, go. And I went and I've always learned that before you do that, you try the Spirit of God. You try his spirit to make sure that it's him. Then you try the word of God. You stay in the word until God speaks. But you try godly counsel. And so I went to a few men that I trusted to get some godly counsel. And so they all said the same thing, but one man I was close to, I had preached for him and done all these things. And he said, man, this is his words to me. He said, son, if you leave that church, you're an idiot. Son, if you walk out of that church, you're an idiot. Now, this is a man that's been pastoring for way longer than I've been alive. I trusted this man. I wanted his counsel. He said, if you walk out of that church, you're an idiot. He said, I find it hard to believe that it's God's will for you to step out when he's blessing that church. He said, son, if you leave that place, you're an idiot. He said, and he used the word, he said, you're stupid one time. That resonated in my mind. For weeks I was praying, but all I could hear was the words of that man saying, you're an idiot. You're an idiot. I was no longer being spirit-led, but I was being fleshly-led. I was being led by what I've heard, not by the word of God. See, we all do that. We question the word of God because somebody else thinks that we can't do it. Hey, we hear the constraints of the people saying you can't do it. You're never going to make it. He told me, he said, son, you'll starve out there on the road. You're never going to make it. Oh, about 6 months after I stepped out, he called me and he said, son, so how's it going? He wanted me to say, it's terrible. I hate it. But I said, hey, let me tell you, hey, we've seen folks saved. People been coming to know Christ. God's opening up doors. Hey, you say, why'd you tell me that story? I told you to tell you this. If God said you can do it, then you can do it. You stand on that word. It don't matter what they say. It don't matter what the people say. If God said so, then you break out of your constraints and say, it don't matter if the doctor said no, Jesus said yes. It don't matter if anybody else says no, Jesus says yes. And you've got to believe by faith and walk in faith and step out of the constraints. I shall not be held down. I will not live in fear, but I will walk in faith, knowing that if he said I could do it, then I can do it. I gotta hurry. Lord, I ain't got past point one. Amen. Watch, he removed him from the constraints, but he moved him from the comfort. No. You got to know blind people. Now, when I was working on the ambulance, we picked up this blind man named John. I can't tell you where at, because I'd get arrested for that. But we picked up this blind man named John. And when I first got my paramedic, I was riding with another medic, and we got called out to John's house, and he said, when you go inside, make sure you keep your head low, duck. And I'm thinking, what's he gonna do, shoot at us? He said, when you go in, just duck. We walk in this door, and all I see is strings going all over the ceiling every which way, like yarn, you know what I mean? Different color yarn all over the ceiling every which way. I said, what's he doing hanging his clothes up in here? He said, no, watch this. He said, John, come in here, it's EMS. I said, hey, bro, he's blind. He said, watch him. He got out of his bed, and he took two steps over to the right, and he put his hand up, and he grabbed that string, and he came right to his recliner, and he sat down. And he said, John, you got any medicine? He said, I do. It's in the cabinet. He said, go get it. I said, man, he's blind. He said, watch him. He got up out of his chair. He took one step over to the lift, put his hand up, grabbed that string, walked straight to the medicine cabinet, got his medicine, and come right back. I said, that's pretty cool, right, John? I would watch him. And so many times we would forget that he was blind because he could move around his house the way he wanted to move. He was comfortable. You would honestly forget he was blind. And we walked out on the porch one day. I'll never forget. We walked out on the porch. I got in front of John and he was standing on the porch. I said, John, let's go to the truck. He said, hey, man, I'm blind. I said, yeah, I forgot. So I went back up to the porch. And what I mean by this is, in his house, in his comfort zone, he could move around comfortably. But when you got him outside of his comfort zone, when you got him living outside the comfort zone, all of a sudden he can't do what he did before. See, there's a lot of us, we'll never get the blessing of God because we want to live in the comfort zone. Well, I'll just sit in my pew and sit in my seat every week and that's all I'll do and I ain't going to do nothing. See, we ain't going to get the blessing of God because we want to live in the comfort zone. We want to live inside our little box and not step out of it. See, if we step out of it, somebody may laugh at us. If we step out of it, we may not do as good. We want to live in the comfort zone. But Jesus said, if you want the blessing, I'm going to take you away from your comfort. I'm going to take you away from all that stuff that's comfortable. See, if you want the blessing of God, you may have to go through some things that ain't comfortable in your life. When we were pastoring, I had to move away from family, pack up the bags and go. Hey, that's not comfortable all the time. But if you want God, you'll do the uncomfortable thing. He did the uncomfortable thing for us. He went up Golgotha. He did not stop. He did not quit. It was uncomfortable, but it kept on going. If you want the blessing of God, you've got to pray like you ain't never prayed before. You've got to worship like you ain't never worshiped before. You've got to call out on God like you ain't never called on him before, because you've got to get out of the comfort zone. He removed him. Number two, he restored him. This is simple as cornbread tonight. We ain't going deep, all right? He restored him. He took him out and he led him away from the town. But notice this. Come here. I got to thinking about how I would lead John. Put your Bible down. Now, what I would do is when I would go back and I'd get John, I would take his arm and I'd put his elbow right here in my chest. And I'd grab him like this right here and we'd walk. And I would turn him like that. He knew to go that way. I'd turn him like that. He knew to go that. It's simple. We just walked together. One day I was being a smart aleck to him. And I said, hey, John, what makes you think I ain't going to run you in that tree over yonder? He said, well, I just trust the one that's got me by the hand. We about to run together, son. He said, I just trust the one that's got me by the hand. Amen. See, I don't know where I'm going. I don't know where he's got me going, but I do trust the one that's got me by the hand. See, there's a lot of Christians today. You need to stop fighting against him and trust the one that's got you by the hand. Where he leads, I'll go. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know what's going to happen when I get there, but I know the one that holds me by my hand, and I know he ain't going to let me fall. He ain't going to let me get hurt. He'll lead and guide and direct me and get me to the place of the blessing. But you've got to trust him tonight. I wonder how many people are trusting God right now. He restored him. Oh, excuse me. He restored him. Watch this. He restored him with spit. Now, I got messed up right here. Watch. And he took the blind man by the hand, verse 23, and led him out of town. And when he had spit on his eyes, you see the word spit there, amen? You see the same word I'm seeing? He said he spit on him. I said, Lord, that don't make a lick of sense. Why'd you spit on my man's eyes? That don't make no sense to me, because if you go over into John, you'll find that the Bible said that the Lord spat on the ground and he made clay with his spittle, and he took the clay and he put it on the blind man's eyes and told him to wash in the pool of Siloam, and the man went and washed and he came forth seeing. Lord, why didn't you spit on the ground again? Why'd you spit in his eyes? It don't make sense. You spit on the ground for one, but yet you spit in the eyes of the other. And for weeks that plagued me. It messed me up for weeks. I said, Lord, why'd you spit in his eyes? And I remember praying and praying and praying. One day I was in my office and I was under my desk praying. And I said, God, why'd you spit in his eyes? And I come up and I did the best thing you can do. I Googled spit. Somebody say amen right there. I Googled spit. How many people know you can find anything on Google? Amen. Some of the older crowd said, I don't know what you're talking about. You can find anything on Google. And I Googled spit. And I began to study it. You say, preacher, that's crazy. No, I'm about to help you because it helped me. I began to study spit, and you know what I found out? I found out that your DNA is in your spit. Somebody ought to say amen right now. Hey, your DNA is in your spit. And God said, you know why I spit on him? I took everything I am. Woo! I took everything that I am and I put it on him. You say, preacher, what is he? Let me refresh your memory. He is the rose of Sharon. He is the lily of the valley. He is the bright and the morning star. He is the Alpha and he is the Omega. He's the first and he is the last. He is the great physician. He is my salvation. He is my redemption. He is my justification. He is the lover of my soul. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is my God. He's my shelter. He's my strength. He's my strong tower. He's my rock. He's my refuge. He's my everything. He is my God tonight. He's the lover of my soul. He said, I took everything that I am and I put it on him. You say, preacher, what's that got to do with me? When you got in the blood, guess what? What's in his blood? His DNA is in his blood. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in this world. I'm glad that he lives within me. I'm an overcomer. I wish somebody tonight would stand up and say, I'm an overcomer because he's in me and I am in him. Woo! Hallelujah! I wish I had some help in here. Woo! I'm glad, thank God. I believe the Shulamite woman said it the best. I am his and he is mine. He lives in my heart. Everything he's got, I've got. The devil ain't got nothing on him. Somebody needs to stand up, look the devil in the face and say he's still God. He lives in my heart. Hey, I don't know about you, but I flipped to the back of the book and found out that we won, that we're victorious. The devil ain't got nothing on us because he put everything he is inside of us. Woo! Cancer. I got God. Hey, y'all ain't hearing me. Problems. I've got God. Hey, glory. He lives in my heart. Now I got to thinking about that. God said, son, I spit on him. I said, oh, God, but you know what I found out? Watch this now. I'm a good spitter. Y'all rednecks up here, good spitters, ain't you? I can hit my marks, hey, man, but I can't spit in your eyes from right here. You know how I got to spit in your eyes? I got to be close to you. I've got to be close. See, some of you want God to put everything on you, but you living over here, and he living over there. You want God to spit on you, but he's living over here. You over there. Lord, I want to be so close to you. If you decide to spit, God, spit on me. God, if you decide to breathe, breathe on me. He breathed on the disciples in John chapter number 20. He breathed on the disciples and said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. And they had peace in their hearts. Lord, if you got to breathe, breathe on me. God, if you need to spit, spit on me. But God, whatever you do, God, wherever you go, just don't go without me there. God, I want to be so close. But watch this now. He spit on his eyes and he asked him if he saw it. And the man said, I see ministries walking. Now about this time, I'm jumping up and down on my desk, having myself a fit. And I read the next verse and I sit down immediately. I see ministries walking. Now, God, that don't make a lick of sense. Lord, you just told me why you spit on him, and now he can't even see. I mean, come on, I know I ain't the only one that reads my Bible like that. God, that don't make no sense. You touched him and you spit on him, and he said, I see ministries. Does that make sense to anybody? Just making sure I ain't by myself. I said, Lord, what are you doing? God, why can't he see? God said, son, read it again. I read it again. Put verse 24 up there. Put verse 24 on the screen. No, watch this. God said, Jesus said, and he asked him if he saw aught. Verse 24 now. And he looked up. Now, he being the blind man, and said, what's the next two words? Say it loud. No. Hold on. In verse 23, he's a blind man. In verse 24, he just said, what? I see. And the Lord said, son, he may not be what he's gonna be. He may not be what he's going to be, but thank God he ain't what he used to be. I may not be perfect. Lucas, I may not be perfect, but I ain't blind no more. I ain't what I used to be. I can see. I may not be able to see this Bible as good as some of you. I may not know it as good as some of these other preachers, but guess what? I once was blind, but thank God, now I see. I ain't blind no more. I ain't what I'm going to be, but thanks be to God, I'm not what I used to be. Somebody in here ought to shout hallelujah that you ain't what you used to be. Woo! He healed him with spit. He healed him with stages. Now watch him. Verse 25 says this. And Jesus touched him again. Does your Bible read like mine? After that, he put his hands again upon his eyes. Do you know the key word in verse number 25? The key word is again. Y'all ain't get it. Again. He said, again. You know, again. He didn't deserve the first one. He didn't earn the first one. He didn't, hey, glory. He didn't pay for the first touch. But God said, I'll touch you again. Hey, glory. You say, preacher, what's that got to do with me? When you got saved, he reached down and he touched you. But thanks be to God, since then, there's been things in my life, Brother Lucas, that's blurred my vision, that's tried to get my eyes off of Christ. But I'm so glad that he'll reach way down and he'll touch me again and again. I didn't deserve the first one, but he touched me again and again. If you've ever been healed, you ought to say hallelujah that he touched you again. If you've ever been forgiven, you ought to say hallelujah that he touched you again. And our God will touch you again and again and again and again. We ought to call time out and shout that he'll touch you over and over and over. I've been touched again and again and again because he's so gracious. When I've been so bad, he'll reach down. He'll reach down and touch me again. When I've failed, he'll reach down and he'll touch me again. What a God. He said, son, I touched you the first time, and I don't owe you a thing, but I'm going to clear it up for you today. Amen. And he touched him again. Now, I got to thinking about this, and I'm hurrying. I'm almost done. I got to think about this. And, oh, God. Whew. Can you think about the first thing this man saw? the Bible said, and Jesus, and he touched him again, and the Bible said, and he was restored. Restored and saw every man clearly. Now the word every man here in verse 25, Jesus removed him from every man. Hey, glory. Back in front. So what man did he see? The first thing he saw, he saw the face. Hey, he saw the face of Jesus Christ. The first thing that his blinded eyes would see. And I can see Jesus saying, son, I know you didn't see me before, but can you see me now? I know you didn't see me over here. I know you didn't see me working, but can you see me now? The first thing he saw was the face of the Almighty. What's that got to do with us? Where's the practicality in that? Watch this. My little baby girl, she's got daddy wrapped around her little finger. And she likes daddy to, she likes when I throw her in the air and catch her. And I'll throw her in the air and she'll shake her head and she'll say, oh, daddy. I threw her the other day. I was at home from meeting and I just got home and I come in and she met me at the door. But we talking about 11:30, 12 o'clock at night, she met daddy at the door. And I come in and I got on my knees. I picked her up and I threw her. She said, oh, daddy. Boy, my heart began to melt. I'd have bought her a car right then if she wanted it. You say, what are you talking about? I told you this morning when we lost our first child, I was serving in church. I was teaching Sunday school. I was paying my tithes. I was faithful to the house of God. God took my baby. Boy, I got angry. And just the other night, for the first time since 2008, when I threw that baby in the air, I've not understood God for years. But for the first time, when I threw her in the air, God said, son, can you see me now? You say, what are you talking about? Had he not took the first one, I wouldn't have that one. And I wouldn't have come in that night tired and weary and had that little baby girl grab hold of daddy's leg. See, sometimes I don't understand what God does. Sometimes I can't see it clearly. But aren't you glad that he'll reach down and touch you and say, can you see me now? Amen. You didn't see me in it before, but can you see me now? He restored him. Lastly, and we're done, he returned him. This is simple as cornbread, ain't it? He returned him. He said, go home. Now watch this. He sent him away to his house saying, neither go into the town nor tell it to any in the town. Again, I'm saying, God, why'd you do that? If you just healed my eyes, I'm running in the town saying, hey, look what he done. See, the Bible tells us, the Bible implies, let's say that this man has seen before. Because the Bible said, and he was restored. Not repaired. He was restored. That means that sometime in his life he's seen. And so people have seen him when his eyes were open. And they've seen him when his eyes are closed. And I said, Lord, why'd you tell him not to tell anybody? God said, son, when I touch him, they'll see the difference. You ain't got to go tell them. They'll see it. Amen. You know that old song? I like that old song. I used to have a man in a church singing it. I'm not the man I used to be. Well, see, when God touches you, there's a change that takes place. Right. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. If there's been no change, friend, there has been no salvation. Because what God touches, he changes. And he said, son, go home. Let everybody see. He walked home changed. walked home complete. But my mind is crazy. I just don't think that this man opened his eyes and seen Jesus and said, "Appreciate it, man. We'll see you next time." See, I don't believe he's Free Will Baptist. Amen. God, I got what I needed. I'll talk to you next time. I believe somewhere, wherever they were, this man got down and said, "Lord, God, you cared about me when nobody else did. Lord, you loved me when nobody else would. God, had it not been for you, I wouldn't have my sight today. Lord, I just want to say thank you." What a powerful, powerful word. Thank you. I was in a meeting in Georgia, and I got to hear, y'all have had her here, Sister Kyla Rowland. Y'all know Kyla Rowland, y'all have had her here, right? Kyla Rowland was singing, and she began, y'all know her, she's redneck, and she got to talking. And she said one day in January up in Tennessee, up in the mountains, it was cold. She said, "I have this little building out behind my house where I pray." And she said, "I walked to the building to go pray and realized that I had not cut the heat on." She said, "So I walked in the building and I come out and I got to go ready to go back out because I was going to wait. And I said, 'Lord, I'll be back when it heats up. I'll come back.'" And she said, "I put my hand upon the door," and she said these words. She said, "Something constrained me." What a powerful word. That word constrained means to be arrested. Paul said, "For the love of Christ constraineth us." She said, "Something constrained me." She said, "I felt God there." She said, "I went back over and I knelt down," and she said, "I began to pray." She said, "It wasn't long that God began to refresh my memory how he had saved my husband and how he had touched me in times of need and how he had gave me a godly mama, how he had done all these things." And she said, "There in the moment, the Holy Ghost of God was in that little room." She said, "I was shouting. I was praising God." She said, "Man, it was so real in there." And she said, "Just like any other time," she said, "he came and he went." She said, "I got done praying and I walked to the door." She said, "I put my hand upon the door, Brother Lucas." And she said, "Yet again, something constrained me." And she said, she turned and she said, "Did I mention that I love you? How I worship and adore you." Me and my little buddy, my son, we ride around in the car and listen to gospel music. And the Perrys, I had the Perry CD in the other day, and that song come on, and my son in the back, "Did I mention that I love him? How I worship and adore him. When I can see no way, he makes a way. And did I mention that he's been faithful to every promise he ever made me? I love him, and that's all I want to say." Lucas, come on. I wonder tonight, and I ask you this morning, but I wonder tonight, when's the last time you just got down at his feet? Said, "Lord, You know, I'm not here to ask you for nothing tonight. Y'all listen, I've got a list of stuff I need to ask God for. I got some stuff I need to get God to do for me. But tonight, put the list aside. Lord, did I mention that I love you? All day long, we've been here, and did I mention today, God? Lord, did I tell you that I love you? My son won't get off the phone with me without saying, Daddy, I love you. I said, baby, Daddy loves you. Well, I wonder if I made up my mind, I ain't getting off the line with him until I say, Daddy, I love you. Just want you to know how much I love you today. Thank you for what you've done. As you stand to your feet tonight all over the house. Lord, I sure love you. When's the last time you just got on your face at these altars? Not in your pews, but in front of God on these altars, and you've got on your face, said, God, with everybody around me, I want them to know I love you. I love you. I challenge you tonight, all over this house, to get on these altars and flood heaven and say, God, from Hayesville, North Carolina, I love you. I love you. I love you. God, I love you. God, I love you. God, I love you. See, sometimes it's right there in the stillness. God, I love you. Lord, I love you. Thank you for my family. God, thank you for my wife. Thank you, Lord, for the clothes on my back, the shoes on my feet. Lord, thank you that I'm saved. Thank you that heaven is my home. Thank you for loving me first. We love him because he has first loved us. As a church tonight, as a body of Christ, while some are shouting over a football game and while some are going to be shouting over a TV tonight, let's shout over a love that's changed us. A love that's mightier, stronger, more powerful than anything in this world.
Jesus passed my way, and he made me whole that day. Just a sinner was I, but then Jesus passed by, and oh, what a change. Since Jesus passed by, a blind man was sitting there by the way. As he cried to Jesus for mercy that day, gave him his sight. So he followed.
Well, I sure love him.
Jesus.
Thank God he passed by.
And I'm sure he died. Jesus passed by.
Are you glad he passed by? Well, I'm glad he passed by Inman, South Carolina one day as a little boy. Thank God he's still passing by.
Just a sinner was I, but then Jesus passed by and knew what a change in my life since Jesus passed by. As the world looks upon me and as I struggle alone, they say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart I'm rejoicing, how I wish they could see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing. Well, I know I'm not wealthy. These clothes, they are not new. I don't have much money. Oh, but Lord, I have you. And to me, that's all that matters. Though the world may not see, thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
Thinking during that song, I think I learned that song at this church, and I think that's probably one of the songs we sing the most around here. And I'm glad we got a church that's thankful for the blessings of God, and I'm thankful for today. I'm thankful for Brother Wesley coming and sharing and speaking to us, preaching to us the Word of God. Amen. And it was what we needed. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward at this time. We're going to take up an offering for Brother Wesley and his ministry. And Brother Wesley's not been in evangelism all that long. And he's got a wife and two kids at home. And this is all he does, is go out and preach meetings like this. And I'd really like for him to walk away from our church this evening with a blessing. And Didn't you enjoy Brother Wesley today? Let's bless him. Let's bless his ministry. I'm going to ask Brother Scotty if he'll come ask the blessing over this offering. Praying for Brother Wesley's ministry. We'll take up an offering. We'll say a few announcements, and then we'll be dismissed.
We thank you, Lord God, for another day in your house, God. We thank you for all the many, many blessings. We thank you for your sweet Holy Spirit today, God. Thank you for the message you sent through Brother Wesley. God, we just pray for your will to be done throughout the rest of the day. God, we pray for this offering, that it be blessed, God, and be used for the upbuilding of thy kingdom. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen. Remember our sign up out in the foyer for our Valentine's banquet. Stop by Brother Wesley's table and pick up some of his CDs. Sign up for his mailing list. I'll buy you one of those towels, Brother Ronnie. That'll look good on your golf bag. And any other announcements I'm missing? Sign up for our Valentine's banquet. Looking forward to next week, next Sunday. Be here Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. Looking for a blessing from God. Let's get our hands up in the air and let's exercise. We'll shout praise the Lord three times. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Good night.